I want to welcome all of you to our speaking series, and this is one of those things that every time I do this, I'm thinking of great speakers and great people who have history of this court, and I couldn't think of anyone better than Judge Spelsey when I thought of him and thought about what great things he's done for our community and this courthouse. As a matter of fact, he was the administrative judge when they moved into this building, so he's got a lot of great stories, a lot of great things in how he had to deal with all the different 34 judges. He's responsible for having 34 judges in Cuyahoga County.
For me, it's a real privilege to introduce a man who's been dedicated to improving justice, not only locally, but nationally. He was born in Cleveland, Ohio. He lived on both sides of the town, not at the same time. His education was at St. Ignatius High School, Georgetown University, Case Western Reserve, School of Law, and then was admitted to the practice in 1959. I want to tell you a little bit about the judge's professional experience. His first year after law school, he became an assistant law director for the city of Cleveland, and that lasted about a year. And then he went to work for John T. Corrigan in the prosecutor's office. That was for 8 years. And in 1968, he was elected to the bench and then reelected in 74, 80, and 86. And then during that period of time, from 1975 to 1990, he was the administrative and presiding judge of the court. In 90, he was elected to the 8th District Court of Appeals and reelected in 96. And then after that, he retired in 2001 and took on the assignment for the asbestos docket in the court. But throughout my years working at the court, I couldn't have had a better boss, a better mentor, and a better friend.
My dad always taught us to do the right thing, and the one thing that comes to mind is actually semi-recently, he was hearing a case across the street in the asbestos docket, and we were talking about something. He said, you know, I think I'm gonna reverse myself in trial. I said, you're going to what? He goes, I'm going to reverse myself. I said, Dad, that's what the Court of Appeals is for. Don't reverse yourself. He said, no, I made a mistake. I thought about it. I made a mistake. I'm going to reverse myself in the middle of trial. I thought about it, and he taught me a lesson, right? Because sometimes we want to let things go, but he had the ability to correct that mistake right there and then, and that's what he did, and that's the kind of guy he is. My dad, Judge Leo Spelsey.
Thank you all for being here. Brendan Sheehan, Judge Sheehan, thank you very much for inviting me to participate in this program. It's not for me, but for the program. I think it's a great thing for the court, not just for me, being here, but for if I can participate in some way for the collegiality that comes about because of your willingness and to bring people together. And it's so important in the court to have the cooperation and just to bring some of the people together here for this brief, and don't believe everything they hear, you know. But the speaker, but for just to be together is very important for, I believe, for the system of justice and for the system in Cuyahoga County. And you're to be commended not for your selection of the speakers necessarily, but for having the group together.
When we built this building, of course, we made sure that the acoustics were perfect.
That's the walls.
That's another story I could tell about those patents in the walls, whether or not they were good for the aesthetics of the building that some people thought they were not, and the jurors got paralyzed looking at them. They're still here. So anyway, yeah, it reminds me that really, mentioning here the important dates that come to mind. This
this is one of them, in 1972, and it was 76 we moved in here, but in December of 76, and 1972, the whole system of justice throughout the state changed. And when I went on the bench in 1969, I came from the county prosecutor's office where I had been for 8 years and had some trial experience there. And I thought that maybe I could handle the cases of both civil and criminal. The presiding judge at that time made a determination as to what docket you would be on, either civil or criminal. And Judge Leibarger said, "You've been a prosecutor for 8 years, and there's no way you can go on criminal cases. You're going to be on civil." Okay, so I went down to the Lakeside Courthouse and had a nice view overlooking the lake. And of course, none of the civil lawyers, they didn't know me. And at that time, the cases were assigned by the assignment commissioner, who was the most powerful person in the courthouse, because he would select where the big, good personal injury case would go, what judge would get that personal injury case. Of course, he didn't want to take any chance of a spellacy for that case, because he didn't know me at the time. Anyway, that changed. So I sat for, I think it was a year and a half, 2 years in the civil docket. Had a nice view overlooking the lake. One of the good things, I was next to Judge Felix Mattiah, who was a very kind gentleman. And he was a great, great judge. Judge Leibarger passed away, and Judge John B. Corrigan became the chief judge. And he said, "Leo," he said, "I'll tell you what, you're going over to criminal, and you're going to preside in the criminal court," which was the old room one where he had all the pleas and all the motions. So it was really an exciting time. It was busy. That was on the criminal courts building, which was on East 21st Street. Any of you here know where, ever seen the criminal courts building, East 21st Street? That was, there were 6 courtrooms in that building, and there was an assignment room. The prosecutor's office happened to be on the first floor. John T. Corrigan, no relation to John B. Corrigan, just happened to work for two Corrigans, John T. and John V. was the chief judge of the county's court. Both tremendous men. They were, of course, they went to St. Ignatius High School. And then John Carroll, and Case Western Reserve Law School, both of them. And they're not related. The only thing that they were both, actually, they were both committed to God and to this country. Both served honorably in the Second World War. But so I was fortunate. John B. then made me presiding judge in the criminal courts building, where all we took were pleas and arraignments. And John T. gave me a prosecutor who was very knowledgeable, and we cleaned up the jail almost at that time. Jail was upstairs from the criminal courts building. Criminal courts building had a lot of history in it. That was where all the big cases were tried. One that I was familiar with was the second Shepherd case was tried there. The first Shepherd case was tried there as well in the criminal courts building. That was the beginning of my term. And then in 1972, the state of Ohio changed from a division of the docket, civil and criminal, and they created what they called the individual docket. each judge would get both civil and criminal cases, which we have now. And so that made it a lot easier on the, it took away the power from the assignment commissioners and gave it to the computer, which, but we did come into the individual docket, which was a great thing, I think, for the court. You then had both civil and criminal cases. And if there was a conflict, it went to the presiding judge who tried to resolve the differences with the lawyers and the people. So that was a big thing in the 70s. I owe a lot of help for Bill Danko, who was there at the time. John Kern was our court administrator, and people like Mary Grayless and John Lavelle. I know I'm going to miss somebody, but one of the persons who was most helpful to me was my bailiff, Jerry Becker, who was very, very understanding, I might say, the problems of the court and of me, and was very helpful. I think maybe I see his daughter back there. Marnie. But anyway, it was a great time, and so I was very fortunate to work for, as I say, John B. Corrigan, who was the presiding judge of the court, and of course, a person who had a lot to do with my abilities as a trial lawyer, John T. Corrigan, who's the county prosecutor, and whose statue is up over in the other building across the street. So, but other than that, I'd be willing to take some questions if anybody has any.
Judge, when you were a prosecutor, you tried the Effley Bailey case. Or you tried the case against Effley Bailey with Sam Shepard.
Who was he?
Yeah, right, who was he, right? Any good stories from that trial?
One story that with Mr. Bailey, we got along pretty well. He was a decent guy. One story had nothing to do with the courtroom, but he called our house one night, wanting to speak to me. It so happens that Cedar and I were out getting a hamburger or maybe even a beer. And my mother-in-law was there watching these guys out here. Mr. Bailey said, is Leo there? She said, no, he's not. Can I ask who's calling? She said, it says F. Lee Bailey. And she said, oh, and with whom am I speaking? She says, I'm just the maid here. She thought we were bumpkin, so she was going to leave.
That's great.
But it was a very exciting times as far as, of course, we didn't get the result that we wanted in that case. It was a, I still think it was a great case, but he had done, you might recall, he was convicted first and he did 10 years in jail. And then the Supreme Court of the United States said that he didn't get a fair trial because of the press that was involved. So we went back and I went to actually Arizona to bring the Hearns back, and they came back willingly to testify. They were the last people that spent the evening with the Shepherds. And Sam fell asleep on a couch in the front room by the door, by the edge of the foot of the stairs. And Marilyn let the Hearns out, locked the door behind him. He testified that the door was locked. anyway, the next thing we know is Sam was asleep on the couch. The next thing we know is his story of what happened. That he heard some noise upstairs at the top of the stairs. He got out. He might have, but one of the things that always amazed me was he had a corduroy jacket on when he fell asleep, and the occurrence walked by him, and he was sound asleep on the couch. Corduroy jacket, when the police got there, was folded neatly on the couch where he had been sleeping. His story, of course, was that he heard this noise upstairs, and he ran up to the top of the stairs, and the guy whacked him and knocked him out, knocked him down, and he came to, and he heard the man in the, somewhere in the library, getting stuff out, and they chased him, never caught him, but chased him. And allegedly, the man was stealing something in the library. And later on, and first of all, when they got the police there and everything, they had a search, and there was a pack of sand going down to the beach from the house. And the Boy Scouts were there searching for whatever was stolen. And they found in a green bag that had everybody testified that was in the library in a bookcase. And in the green bag was a watch, Marilyn's watch, some rings and stuff. And of course, when they found Marilyn had been beaten pretty badly, but the watch, the imprint of the watch was on her wrist when they came. And so whoever this burglar was, killed her, took her watch off her, put it in a bag from the library. And I'll give my final argument now.
Yeah.
No, nobody believed it. But and they put it in a bag, so they found this bag in the back of Sandra, whoever Sam was chasing, who had beaten him up, incidentally, and knocked him out. They found it in the person had thrown it in there, and the watch had blood splatters on the face of it. So it was obviously on her wrist when this altercation took place. But be that as it may, that this is some of the physical evidence that was we argued. And I thought it was pretty good circumstantial evidence that somebody did it besides the culprit that knocked Sam out top of the stairs and took time to get something out of the cupboard and put the watch in it and the rings and stuff like that.
Judge Mathai, you have a question?
Yeah. Judge Pelosi, this is one of the few buildings in the country where two different courts reside. Could you give us some historical context of how Cleveland Muni Court and Cuyahoga County Common Pleas Court got to be married under one roof?
There was a bond issue that was created by legislation, and I think by the fact that that the voters voted on it. I think the selling point was the fact that it was housed both the Common Pleas Court and the Cleveland Municipal Court, as well as, at the time, the police station and the jail. So we moved, that's how the Cleveland Municipal Court came into the building.
Where was Cleveland Muni Court was housed where before this building?
Pardon me?
Where was Cleveland Muni housed before?
Cleveland Mooney was divided just like we were. They had some city hall, some courtrooms in city hall, and then there was, they were on a, behind, on Payne Avenue and 21st, there was a, the traffic court, some of the courtrooms were there. The criminal, the, right next to the criminal courts building. Criminal courts building was on 21st Street. That housed common police court, criminal division, and the jail. Jail was upstairs. And they, it was a an older building, and it had a lot of character to it. And they, there were six courtrooms, and as I said before, all the trials that, up until the individual docket was created were criminal trials. And I might say that, that just from my experience in the criminal cases, we wouldn't know, as a prosecutor, we wouldn't know what case was going to take place until the assignment commissioner made a decision that this case for James Smith is going to go into Judge Smith's court, or Judge, let's say, Perino's court. And we would find out maybe at 3 o'clock in the afternoon that that case was going to go to trial the next morning. And we would hope that the detective who was assigned to that case would find the witnesses. And before, many times the judge would say, okay, we'll start the jury selection right now, you know, 3 o'clock. And he wouldn't have any witnesses there, we'd just start the case, and start, he'd try not to give opening statement because he didn't know if the witness was going to show the next morning or not. And hopefully the detective would allow to find the witnesses. That was the way the cases, the criminal cases were tried in those days. Now you have, you know, you have a little better handle on what the judge does, because that case is assigned to a judge at the time of the arraignment. We didn't, you know, no case was assigned to a judge in, under the old system until the assignment commission decided that it's going to go to Judge so-and-so. I remember as a prosecutor, I was assigned, you were assigned two prosecutors to a courtroom and in the old criminal courts building. And I was fortunate to work with a number of very distinguished judges and good ones. I remember I was assigned with a certain prosecutor to Judge Ardell's courtroom, who was a very distinguished, really a great judge. And he says, Spellacy, he says, you've got every case in this courtroom from now on. He says, I don't want to see that other guy.
Judge, how many assistant prosecutors were there when you were in the office? About.
About? So I'm just trying to probably count down the
Ballpark.
About 12. Well, there was, let's see, how many courtrooms? Four courtrooms. In the, I'd say 12, 14.
And now there's over 150 in the criminal division, I think. Are there any prosecutors here? I mean, what
I could be wrong. Let's see, I'm just trying to think. That's going down the hall.
That's rough, about right, Judge. Yeah. Huh? That's right. It's, it was about 12. 12, 13.
Well, I shared an office with
The criminal division. Yeah. There were a couple others there.
I shared an office with George Moscarino and Henry Zimmer. Wow. Now we had, and that was, there was not much confidence in, when you had a witness, you know, George would say, ask him this way. You know, we had a lot of help.
Any cases from your time as a judge that have really stayed with you?
I'm sorry, I can't.
Any cases from your service as a judge that really stayed with you?
Any cases
that you stayed with you that you remember?
Well, of course, the Shepherd case, I remember that. Another case that, huh?
As a judge.
As a judge. I don't know. I just want to mention this other case that was a criminal case that I happened to be involved in as a prosecutor. The guy's name, the victim's name was Ganzerski. And he was lived out on Smith Road in Middlebrook Heights, I believe it was. And he was had a collection of rare coins. And he would, as a habit, would go down to the basement and go through the coins. And they were very, very, very valuable. Well, it so happens that he was doing this one evening, and some people who obviously knew what he was up to and doing broke into the side door of his house, came down, pistol whipped him, and chained him to the furnace, and took the coins. Well, he found out through his sources, which were questionable, I guess, anyway, who the people were, and went to the police and ultimately ended up an indictment, these two people. Well, I happened to be the prosecutor assigned to try the case, and we impaneled a jury. Judge Jaffe, I believe, was the judge. We impaneled a jury, and I was going to give, I said, Judge, we had to wait. No, it was Judge Friedman. Anyway, we got to wait and give opening statements in the morning because I don't know if we're going to, you know. So sure enough, I get a call at about 9 o'clock at night from the Middlebrook Heights Police Department. They blew up Kanzerski's front porch. They said, don't testify. So anyway, I said, oh my God. He said, you've been very careful because they know who you are, so you better have some protection. So I called the Rocky River Police, and it just happened to be snowing a lot that night. You know. Well, they said, we'll take care of it, Judge. Don't worry about it, you know. Anyway, I looked out the window, and there wasn't a car's track going down the street at all. Good thing they didn't know exactly where it was. But anyway, there was a great big article in the paper in the Plain Dealer next morning that Kanzerski's house was blowing up. And of course, we had already impaneled the jury, so they said, you know, there's a mistrial here. So we had to cancel it, call it off because of the publicity at the time. Couldn't get a fair trial. The jury had already been sworn, and I think we had made open arguments, but Judge Friedman declared a mistrial. It's not even sure it happened. So. But that's another example of a case.
Judge, you testified before the state legislature for more judges in Cuyahoga County. Do you have any good stories about that time, or how did you come up with the idea that you needed more judges in Cuyahoga County?
Well, we're going to move into this building, as a matter of fact.
Okay.
So there's going to be space, and we had a committee that went through statistics and everything, and we had a very good argument for additional judges. And I went down to, I was presiding judge at the time. I went to the county commissioners because they're the ones that were going to fund part of it. And I went to the county commissioners and they said, made my argument, and they said, okay, we got the space, there's going to be room in here in this building for additional judges. And I went down and testified before the legislature, and they were very receptive. I worked under the assumption you can never get more than you ask for. So I asked for 10 judges. 10 new judges. legislature gave us five. So one of the judges who was in the conference room when I was making my argument was a Judge Kessler from, I believe it was in Dayton. And see Dayton?
Yeah.
He called me and said, hey, he says, I'm really upset. He says, they didn't give you the judges you wanted. I said, Carl, I only wanted five. We got the five new judges when we moved in here. Anyway, but there was, I think we had two others then, additional a little later. This building was great. And I mean, it solved so many problems with regard to logistics. I know it's not perfect, but it has. It's really helped the system of justice in this county.
Judge, you got 5 minutes left. Mark, you.
If I could, Your Honor, seriously, this time you were the prosecutor in the Sam Shepard case. You worked with some legendary prosecutors, some of whom are not defined defense attorneys, but Judge Sheehan's had a series of speakers here that preceded you. Jerry Gold, Jim Willis, Harry Hanna, who later became a judge. But all those three gentlemen were legendarily great criminal defense lawyers. Could you give us an example of a couple others that you met over the years and really what established them as great defense attorneys in your mind?
Phil Bergate comes to mind. Norman Miner, who was a gentleman and he just had a way with people, a way with jurors. I remember trying cases against him, and everybody else was jotting down notes and everything. He'd lean over and say, you got a pen? Give a pen, and he'd take out a matchbook out of his pocket and open it up and take the pen out. What do you say? Of course, everybody's watching him, not the jury. You know, that I mean, not the argument that you might make. And he was a legend. I remember trying a case with him as a prosecutor, and there was a judge just came on the bench, a nice man, Perry Jackson, and happened to be, and Perry's very, very to the point, and Norman had a woman who had stabbed her husband, and It was a family dispute, and Norman was very afraid of Judge Jackson. He said, would you go in and tell him that this is not a... Judge Jackson had never been in criminal court that we know. He was domestic relations. And so Norman wanted me to go in and lobby for him for the case, which I did, and because I was afraid he was going to send this poor woman away to jail, you know? And it was a self-defense type argument. And, so we were able to work it out. Norman Miner was that kind of a very tactful, good lawyer. And he was a prosecutor one time, but Norman, I'm just trying to think of some other, besides Mark Stanton.
Legendary for the wrong reason.
Judge, any advice? I got a lot of young lawyers, people here, to them practicing in your long career as a judge and as a lawyer, any good advice for any of them?
Well, I think that, I think one of the things that First thing is, be straightforward, be honest. Don't try to gild the lily too much, you know. You've got to be factual and honest with regard to the facts. The facts make the law, the facts make the case. And if you don't have the facts, I guess you can argue the law. If you don't have the law, you argue the facts. But I think that, you know, another thing is I think as I've told Kevin, you meet the same people on the way up as you do on the way down, so you got to treat everybody fairly. Try to do that. As far as the judge is concerned, I know that as far as my experience was, the hardest thing was sentencing. And I'm sure that Judge Sheehan was the same, and all the, even Judge Stanton will find that out. But it is hard. You try to balance the society, good for society, as well as what's good for the individual. And some people can learn from 30 days in jail or 3 minutes in jail. So it's you don't want to ruin somebody for life. Of the arbitrary power that judges have. That's awesome responsibility. I have, you know, I mentioned before that the two Corrigans that I worked for with John V and John T, not related in any way, other than their love of God and love of country. Those two things they had in common, and I learned a lot from them. So, that's all I have to say.
Great. Thank you very much.